story of Jesus. Let's stand and let's worship together.
Father, we love you. Lord Jesus, we praise you and we thank you for the blood, for the covenant, for loving us enough to die for us. And today we memorialize that. We even celebrate that with Lord's Supper. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will meet with us, anoint this service in a very, very special way as we sing your praises, as we give our tithes and offerings, as we listen to and are involved in the teaching and the preaching of the Word of God. May it take root in our hearts and change us forever. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I hope you have your very cool signature unique bulletin. There's never been one like this before. This is Senior Adult Sunday at Kingsland. And are you appreciative of our great big senior choir up here? Thank you, seniors. We have a very, very special day planned with a lot of different things, some acknowledgments and so forth. And right now I want to invite Carl Wilson, who is our senior adult department director. He's going to come and take it from here.
We have Fred Boling come down, please. While Fred's coming down, today the senior adults will recognize one of their own, and of course this is Fred Bowen, and as he makes his way down. Fred's been a member of Kingsland for the past 51 years. During this time, he has served the Lord in various areas. He has taught a men's Bible study class for 49 years and has been in the choir for 49 years. And he has participated in various outreach programs sponsored by our church, the latest being Operation Chesterfield. And he's become a part of this program since its inception. It's an honor for me to call Fred a friend. I've known him for many, many years. And we just want to thank him for his faithful service to our Lord. And Fred, if you would accept this little token, the gift, to show our appreciation for you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, brother. Thank you. It's been a pleasure to be a member of this church. Yeah. I'm not going to sing.
Well, let's stand and continue to worship.
Watch and pray, find it. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for the amazing grace where you sent your Son that his blood may cover our sins, and we'll have this privilege of lifting up our prayers to you, God, to stand in your light. God, thank you for the beauty of the springtime all around us. God, we come here this morning to worship you and to praise you and to receive from you a message. But God, we also come to bring to you our tithes and our offerings. And to God, we just pray that you will use it to reach other people for Christ. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Savior, precious Redeemer and souls of men. Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost their way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Rita. Thank you, senior adult choir. Thank you, Erica, our pianist for the day. Did a great job with that. And we are here to bring worship and honor and glory to our wonderful, merciful Savior who shed his blood on the cross for our sins. And we will start at this point. Instead of finishing with this, we're going to start with this today. We're going to start with the Lord's Supper. And I want to encourage you to free your mind of all the other things that are going on, to think inside, to think about your life. Here is our model from the Apostle Paul, who we'll read more from later. He says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, to the churches in Corinth. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So we know that out of all the things we're supposed to do as a church, we're ordered to do two. One is to do Lord's Supper. The second one is to baptize those who have given their heart to Christ. Next Sunday morning, we'll have a baptism. If you need to be baptized, come forward and request it today. We'll baptize you next Sunday morning. But today, for those of us who know the Lord Jesus personally, for those of us who have received Christ, we regularly participate in Lord's Supper, symbolically receiving him. These elements are symbolic of what he did for us. So, Lord, I pray that you would bless us now as we partake of Lord's Supper, as we memorialize your death, which we will proclaim until you come back to get us. We thank you for loving us so much that you would die for us. We thank you for giving us the gift of eternal life. And right now, Lord, I pray that we would make good use of this time in this quiet moment to repent, to ask you to cleanse, to confess, to admit things that shouldn't be in our lives that are there, that they are there, and to repent of it and to turn away from it. Lord, I pray that we would be clean vessels that you can use for maximum impact in your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Lord Jesus said, "This is my body offered for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And Lord, now I pray that you would bless us as we partake in this remembrance of your blood shed for our sins. It's a horrific thought that you had to go through all that pain, that suffering. But Lord, we acknowledge that you did it so that we wouldn't have to. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for forgiving me. Thank you for living in me. And thank you for your blood that washed away my sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Jesus went on to say that this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me. And we do remember. As our deacons go back to their seats there, I sure appreciate them. And kids owners, if you haven't already gone, if you're in kids zone, head on out. Kindergarten, first, second grade, got a note on that there. I love our deacons. They gave me a GPS a few years ago. And it was a subtle hint to, you know, quit getting lost. And they gave me this thing, and I used it this morning, so I really appreciate it. And I think it's interesting, now that we have these GPSs, of course, most of you, I know, you're very high-tech, and you have it on your phone. Who has it on their phone? They don't need, yeah. Well, it's just very interesting to me how much we will rely on something like this. How much do you rely on the Holy Spirit? How much do you rely? Have you ever had an experience with the Holy Spirit? Today's been kind of mellow, and that's okay. We've had time to think and reflect and be reflective. In times like that, I think about the times I've had with the Holy Spirit. You see, the Holy Spirit of God is our comforter, our guide. We've talked a lot about it in the book of Acts. Go over to Acts chapter 19, and he is our counselor. He's better than GPS, way better. But the average person will trust a little gizmo like this, but will not, sometimes, not trust the God who created everything. Heard a song this morning that said, it's a casting crown song, driving in, if we've ever needed him, Lord, it's now. And isn't that the truth? We desperately need the Holy Spirit. We are in desperate need of the Holy Spirit to intervene in our lives. And Paul, a missionary, first and foremost, so many other things, but he was a missionary. He was relying on the Holy Spirit, leading him from place to place. And boy, who said the Bible's boring? I mean, goodness, it is anything but boring. And the text we're going to read this morning, and we will read through this entire chapter. I will not preach the entire chapter. We'll do half this week, half next, but we'll read through the whole chapter. But just in this one chapter alone, you have speaking in tongues, 2,000 years later, still debatable. What does that mean? What is that? How does that work? Miraculous healings, not just healings, not just miraculous healings, extraordinary miraculous healings. Public nudity in this chapter. Holy handkerchiefs, a riot, and 2 hours of people in Ephesus chanting something for 2 hours. Because 2,000 years ago, people were crazy and would chant for 2 hours. We would never do that in our sophisticated society today, right? Okay, so this is good stuff. And I've titled the message, Church Planting in Ephesus. Church Planting in Ephesus. God can save and change and use anyone. The whole point of Lord's Supper is to look back to when Christ came into your life and washed away your sins and saved you and then changed you and now will use you. God can save anybody who will rely on the Holy Spirit and invite the Holy Spirit to come in and save him. God can change anybody who will operate under the power of the Holy Spirit. God will use anyone who relies on the Holy Spirit. If you're relying on your own resources and strength and wisdom and skills and personality and memory and all this kind of thing, that's not enough. It's the Holy Spirit that blesses us. It's the Holy Spirit. And when he went into Ephesus with his team, lives were changed. That's the whole point of church planting. You know, we know a little bit about church planting, right? I mean, we have a church plant that meets right in our facility. Nueva Esperanza will meet this afternoon. And man, they're doing great things for God. People's lives are being changed. And God is using them through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what church planting is all about. And, of course, we're in a convention of many churches, over 500 churches in Virginia, who are always trying to plant churches. We're giving money to that. We should be inspired to give a whole lot more of ourselves to that. Some of you may be inspired or challenged or led of the Holy Spirit to go be a part of that. And we shouldn't be going, no, don't go. We don't want you to go. We love you. Don't leave. We should say, man, go get them. It's hard for me to do that. I'll be honest with you. I hate to see people go. How about the petty people? I'm going to Africa in 3 weeks. And we will be ministering to the petty people for the purpose of leading them to Christ and to start churches. There's some there. There will be more. We found out this past week that there is a missionary that has been assigned to the petty people as of this past week. How cool is that? So we're going to have a missionary to work with over there. So we want to plant churches in Africa. We want to plant churches in Virginia and everywhere in between. We do that through the power of the Holy Spirit, believing that the church is the best hope for the world. It's the best thing. It's God's instrument for how lives are changed. People will get saved, their lives will be changed, and he will use them forever. Okay, so think of people who God has changed their lives. I love that. I love knowing people here in our church who God is just totally, just looking at you eyeball to eyeball. Some of you have given your testimonies, and it is a testimony of a completely changed life. I think of Chuck Smith back in the 70s, ministering to the hippies who were smelly and on dope and greasy, and nobody wanted anything to do with them. But Chuck Smith did. He loved them, and he led one of them to Christ. He led many of them to Christ. But one of them he led to Christ is Greg Laurie, who is now doing harvest crusades all over the West Coast, I guess all over the world, but the ones I've seen are on the West Coast. Thousands of people are hearing the gospel because a hippie got saved and totally, totally, totally changed his life. Think about the Franklin Graham story. We talk about Billy Graham and all that God's done through him. His son was a rebel. His son was against the things of the Lord, and God totally changed his son. And I'm sure out of all the millions of people that have come to Christ through Billy Graham's ministry, that's the one, and his own children are the ones he's worried about the most. Think of Pastor Frank LaPierre. And all with this being Senior Sunday, if you were here during the ministry of Pastor Frank LaPierre, raise your hand, please. A lot of you were. And you know, God totally, totally changed his life. I love to hear Mrs. LaPierre tell me the story. She has on several occasions of how this man did not know the Lord, did not love the Lord, did not have any knowledge of God, and God radically, totally changed his life. And look what he did. And look how God has used him. Robert Chapman. I had a chance to talk to Robert Chapman not long ago. And this is a young man who grew up in our community, who did not know the Lord, living in sin and drugs and all that. Totally, God totally, totally, totally changed his life. He can do that for you. The power of the Holy Spirit that lives in all those people lives in you if you know the Lord. If you don't know the Lord, give your heart to Christ today. And you will have a power living within you that could literally change the world, starting with your world. Okay, so when we read this passage, and we'll read through the whole thing today, we'll analyze a little bit of it today, we'll do the rest next week, okay? Let's read it together. Acts 19, when Apollos was in Corinth. Now, we just got introduced to Apollos at the end of last week. Do you remember him? He loved the Lord. He was a disciple of John. He had not yet received the Holy Spirit. And Aquila and Priscilla helped educate him in the things of the Lord and helped train him, helped disciple him. And he began a relationship with Christ. So when Apollos was in Corinth, Paul traveled through the interior regions and came to Ephesus. He found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" "No," they told him, "we haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." Now, I want to do some commentary as we read this. Don't want to forget it and don't want to leave it out till next week. No, we haven't. They knew they hadn't received the Holy Spirit. They didn't even know he existed. They had believed under John's gospel 20 years earlier. But what we see here is they believed in the gospel of John, who was pointing towards Jesus. They had not been born again. It's a very important fact as we read beyond this. "Then with what baptism were you baptized?" he asked them. "With John's baptism," they replied. Paul said, "John baptized with a baptism of repentance, telling the people that they should believe in the one who would come after him." And here's the million-dollar question, disciples of John. "That is Jesus." Jesus is the one he was talking about. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began to speak with other tongues, other languages, and to prophesy. Now, there were about 12 men in all. Okay, so they're speaking in tongues, just like they did at Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came upon the Jews. Just like they did when Cornelius was born again, a Gentile, when Christ came upon, or the Holy Spirit came upon the Gentiles. Now, there's a lot of some things this text says, there's some things this text doesn't say. It doesn't say that this is a signature gift of anybody who ever receives the Holy Spirit for all time. When we started the Acts series, and then when we restarted the Acts series, we said the book of Acts is a transitional book from one covenant to another covenant, from one dispensation to a new dispensation, from one era to a new one. And before the book of Acts, they worshipped on Saturday, on the Sabbath. After the book of Acts, they worshipped on Sunday. Before the book of Acts, they and before the ministry of Christ, they worshipped God. They didn't know the Son of God's name would be Jesus. Jesus came in human flesh, God in human flesh, died on the cross, buried, rose again. In the book of Acts and beyond, we worship Jesus. We know this, he's the second part of the triune Godhead, second member of the triune Godhead. So, and we also learn that Acts describes a lot of events, but it doesn't always prescribe exactly how things have to happen. In fact, if anything, we learn, if we really read the book of Acts with an open mind, we would probably learn that the way we do church, a lot of the things we do, we could do or we couldn't do. Some of the things people would probably have a fit if we didn't do. Well, you don't have to do it that way. It's a transitional book, and it describes a lot of what happened. And it prescribes a little bit of what should happen. So in this text, what we just read described how the Lord saw fit to pour out the Holy Spirit on these disciples of John who had no knowledge of the Holy Spirit, much like the people at Pentecost, much like the people in Cornelius's day. In verse 8, then he entered the synagogue and spoke boldly. Over a period of 3 months, engaging in discussion and trying to persuade them about the things related to the kingdom of God. I love this because this is describing what Paul did, but we take the principle here, we take the example and say, man, he was willing to really push. He was really, really willing to get into deep conversations and even debate about Jesus. He didn't just sit back and go, well, some will come, some won't come, we'll just sort of hang out and do our thing. No, nothing like that. He was aggressive. He was passionate about sharing the gospel. But when some became hardened and would not believe, slandering the way. Now, the way, capital W, the way, is talking about Christianity. In front of the crowd, he withdrew from them and met separately with disciples, conducting discussions every day in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. So the ones who said, no way, Jose, we don't want your Jesus, we don't want your Christianity, we don't want to know the way, finally, after 3 months, he said, okay. He went into more of a closed-door discipleship mode. And this went on for 2 years. So all the inhabitants of the province of Asia, both Jews and Greeks, heard the word of the Lord. Now, Paul stayed in Ephesus, but he sent out trained converts to places like Colossae, where we get the book of Colossians, and Araminus, Turkey, Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey, and Hierapolis. And then if you look at the seven churches in Revelation, most likely this is where they were sent. And it's almost like he had a little Bible institute or something there in Ephesus where they were trained and commissioned and then sent out. God was performing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. Wow, that's an interesting verse there, verse 11. You should underline, God, not big name celebrity with the big poofy hair and all the jewelry and the rings and the Wu Manchu and the God was performing extraordinary, not just miracles, extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul. Man, wouldn't it be great to one day say, wow, God did something extraordinary through my life. That's what Paul could say. That's what I want to say with my life. I believe that God can save anyone, change anyone, and use anyone, including you, including the people that walk up and down the pike, including the people that live in your neighborhood. He will save anyone. He will change anyone, and he will use anyone. So, that face cloths or work aprons or handkerchiefs that had touched his skin were brought to the sick, and the diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Now, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, saying, well, here's why we believe this, and here's why they believe that, and here's why you can call, 1-900-HANDKERCHIEF, and some modern-day apostle will wipe off his forehead and mail it to you, and you can heal somebody with it. They come up with that stuff. They didn't just pull that out of thin air, although they do pull some things out of thin air. They came up with that out of a misunderstanding of the modern-day apostle. Paul was an apostle. He met Christ personally. He saw Christ personally. These apostles had, and again, extraordinary miracles. Not just miracles, extraordinary miracles. And in this case, this is an amazing thought that they would even want something that had touched him. Verse 13, then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists attempted to pronounce the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I command you by the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches. They didn't know Jesus. but they wanted to give it a try. Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. Now, we're not sure if he was a real chief priest, because there's no record of him, or if he was he was bogus. But anyway, these guys are out there trying to cast out demons. They don't even have the Holy Spirit. They're not saved. Look at verse 15. Then the evil spirit answered them, "Jesus I know, Paul I recognize, but who in the world are you?" Then the man who had the evil spirit leaped on them. "If this wasn't in the Bible, you wouldn't even believe me." He overpowered them all, prevailed against them, so that they ran out of the house naked and wounded. This became known to everyone who lived in Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks. So what did that do? That helped people to understand the Spirit of God is a real thing, to be revered, to be taken very seriously. Then fear fell on all of them, and the name of the Lord was magnified. And many who had become believers came, confessing and disclosing their practices. While many of those who had practiced magic collected their books and burned them in front of everyone, so they calculated their value and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver. Jesus sold for 33 pieces of silver from Judas. Imagine how much 50,000 pieces of silver is worth, and they burn it up. In this way, the Lord's message flourished and prevailed. So what we see here is radical transformation, radical lifestyle change. They said, "I'm not listening to that anymore. I'm not being entertained by that anymore. I'm not going to worship that anymore," and they burn it up. If we were going to have a very literal reading of this, we would have a big bonfire after church. And we'd go home and we'd get our DVDs that we shouldn't have, and maybe even our laptops like we shouldn't have. Remember that movie where the guy took the baseball bat to his laptop because he couldn't control himself? We'd get some laptops, and we'd get some magazines and some junk, and we'd have us a big bonfire. That's what they did. Okay, so in verse 21, the people that were making money off of all those, you know, the false idols and so forth, weren't exactly excited about the bonfire. When these events were over, Paul resolved in the spirit to pass through Macedonia and Achaia and to go to Jerusalem. "After I've been there," he said, "I must see Rome." Now, this is very important to the book of Acts. You might want to circle the book of the city of Rome. He had interactions with people who had been in Rome, like Aquila and Priscilla, had not been to Rome, and he was dead set on going to Rome. "So after sending two of those who assisted him, Timothy and Erastus, to Macedonia, he himself stayed in the province of Asia for a while." During that time, there was a major disturbance about the way. Now, things are going to get real ugly real quick, and this major disturbance, if we fast forward up to modern times, the best way to think of it is this. If you will just maintain your Christianity and shut up about it, you're not going to have a whole lot of problems. If you will follow Christ secretly, you are in good shape. And if you will blend into the world around you that you live in, you're probably going to be okay. But the moment you take your faith seriously, and I'm not talking about being obnoxious, I'm not talking about picking fights, I'm talking about just honestly, sincerely taking your faith very seriously and saying, "There's some things I'm going to do, there's some things I'm going to do, there's some places I'm going to go, there's some places I'm not going to go, there's some things I'm not going to laugh about. I'm going to take a stand. And I'm on my way to heaven because I've been saved, and God changed me, and now he's using me. I'm going to take everybody I can with me." The second you start thinking that way, acting that way, there might be a disturbance in your office too, or in your town, or in your neighborhood. You may not be as cool as you thought you were, and people won't think you're nearly as cool as they used to think you were. "For a person named Demetrius, a silversmith, who made silver shrines to Artemis," or Diana, your translation might say Diana, "it provided a great deal of business for the craftsmen. When he assembled them," now we're not sure if he's like a union leader or what, but he had the ability to assemble these guys, "as well as the workers engaged in this type of business, he said, 'Men, you know that our prosperity is derived from this business. You both see and hear that not only in Ephesus, but in almost the whole province of Asia, this man Paul has persuaded and misled a considerable number of people, saying that gods made by hands are not gods.'" Very interesting verbiage there. He's misled them by saying that gods made by hands aren't gods. What a liar. Obviously, these metal things we've crafted are real gods. We all know that. Okay, so they are, and this is the epicenter for worship of Diana. The great temple of Diana was located in Ephesus. It was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. This was a big deal. They made a lot of money from this. This was what they were known for. And this is a classic argument against Christianity. You foolish Christians, you're misleading everybody into thinking that heaven is real and hell is real and the Bible is true. And that we were created out of nothing by God. You silly Christians. I won't have time to get into this much today, but I can't wait till next week because I really believe this is what's happening in our day. We are being accused of misleading people. Verse 27, so not only do we run a risk that our business may be discredited, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis, or Diana, may be despised and her magnificence come to the verge of ruin. The very one the whole province of Asia in the world adore. Isn't it sad to think that when we stand up for Christ and we do the right thing, we are going to step on some of the world's sacred cows and their toes, and they aren't going to like that because they love it. They really and truly love it. When they'd heard this, they were filled with rage and began to cry out, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." So the city was filled with confusion and rushed all together into the amphitheater, dragging along Gaius and Aristarchus, Macedonians, who were Paul's traveling companions. Though Paul wanted to go in before the people, because Paul was half crazy, they had probably pulled him apart. The disciples did not let him. Even so, the provincial officials of Asia, who were his friends, sent word to him, pleading with him not to take a chance by going into the amphitheater. Meanwhile, some were shouting one thing and some another, because the assembly was in confusion. And most of them did not even know why they'd come together. And that makes me think of the masses, the millions, the billions in our world that just have no clue. No clue. They're just kind of going along, floating downstream with the crowd. Then some of the crowd gave Alexander advice when the Jews pushed him to the front. So motioning with his hand, Alexander wanted to make a defense to the people. But when they recognized that he was a Jew, a united cry went up from all of them for about 2 hours. Now, there's something I want to say about that. Anti-Semitism was alive and well in the first century. It's alive and well today. And never forget the unity and the relationship that the church has with Israel. And a united cry went up for 2 hours. United. I circled that word in my Bible because I wrote this note. Unity is not always good. Today I'm thinking about unity. I'm thinking about our church and I'm thinking about the church and how much more united and harmonious we need to be. But you know, unity isn't always good. When we unite together for something that's wrong, that's bad. And that's what they did. However, when the city clerk, that's kind of like their mayor, had calmed down the crowd, he said, "Men of Ephesus, what man is there who doesn't know that the city of the Ephesians is the temple guardian of the great Artemis and of the image that fell from heaven?" Most likely a meteor fell there and they built a temple around it and they worshiped it. "Therefore, since these things are undeniable, you must keep calm and do not do anything rash. For you have brought these men here who are not temple robbers or blasphemers of goddesses. So if Demetrius and the craftsmen who are with them have a case against you, the courts are in session and there are proconsuls. Let them bring charges against one another. But if you want to do something else, it must be decided in a legal assembly. In fact, we run a risk of being charged with rioting for what has happened today." And that would have been a very bad charge for the city that the Roman government would have taken very seriously. "Since there's no justification we can give as a reason for this disorderly gathering." After saying this, he dismissed the assembly and they went home. Okay. I would like to give you some homework this week. Read that chapter again on your own, and we'll discuss the later part of it next week. We're really breaking into two sections, the spirit and the crowd. The spirit, the first half of the chapter, and the crowd, the second half of the chapter. And we won't even go all the way through the spirit today. Remember, the Holy Spirit, it's kind of like being on a sailboat. When you can put up your sail, but if there's no wind, you're just sitting there. Right? The church is like a sailboat sitting there, and if the Holy Spirit wind doesn't come and drive us, man, we're out of luck. We're not going to go anywhere. It's kind of like solar power. And when the sun's not out, you're not going to get any. And we depend on the Son of God through the power of the Spirit of God to energize us. The Holy Spirit will baptize you one time. He will fill you repeatedly, and He will transform your life and use you to impact the world around you. So, He can save you, change you, and use you. Which one do you need today? maybe need to be saved and start to have a relationship, invite Christ into your life through the presence of the Holy Spirit to save you, and then he'll change you. I think we're all there. Then he'll use you. Wouldn't it be great to think at this point in your life, wherever you are on your journey, that the Holy Spirit could and would and desires to use you in greater ways than he ever has before? Our church is 107 years old. We'll celebrate that birthday in a few weeks. 107 years old. Today's Senior Adult Sunday, where we thank God for the heritage and the legacy of those who have come before us. Many of them have already passed on. Many of them are still here, serving faithfully, setting an example. You think about the seniors, and you think down to the boomers who are becoming seniors. That's pretty amazing. The baby boomers are earning into retirement age. Then you go into that, you go to the Generation X, and I know there's a lot of subdivisions in between there. When you think about what the Holy Spirit of God wants to do in our church and in our lives, it involves all of us. That's one of the unique characteristics of our church. We really wouldn't be the same church if one of those groups decided, I'm not coming anymore. It'd be pretty bad for us, wouldn't it? We wouldn't look the same. We wouldn't be the same. We desperately need one another. We rely on the Holy Spirit's working in our lives to work things out and to keep us in a spirit of harmony and unity. You can become a Christian. You cannot become a Christian without the Holy Spirit. Look at verse number 2 in our text. Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? What did they believe on? John's baptism, not the gospel of Jesus Christ. No, they told him, we haven't even heard that there is such thing as a Holy Spirit. You can't become a Christian without the Holy Spirit. Maybe you're here today or listening on our cable program and you've never even really heard of the Holy Spirit. You need the Holy Spirit in your life. We used to sing a song, I think the choir did, we can't have church until the Holy Ghost shows up. Well, that's true. Without the Holy Spirit, church is a major waste of time, and it's more dangerous than helpful because it gives off the image of spirituality, even holiness, even reverence. But it is completely dead and lifeless. And I submit to you this morning, there are many churches across our city, across our land, across the world, that are absolutely dead. They're meeting today because that's what they've always done. And there is no Holy Spirit. There is no life. They are dead as a doornail. My admonition this morning is this. Kingsland Baptist Church needs more of the Holy Spirit, not less. We must not live our lives in fear of, oh no, we don't want to be branded or typecasted or stereotyped as those crazy people over there. When the Holy Spirit shows up, he saves us, he changes us, he uses us, and we should not be afraid of that. We need to embrace that. And it's a very dangerous thing to have a lot of religion and no Holy Spirit, to have a lot of meetings and no anointing. Turn over to Titus chapter 3. I want you to see a little bit more about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit does when he comes into your life. Turn over in your Bibles to Titus chapter 3, starting in verse 3. Titus chapter 3, verse 3. And this whole subject of unity came to my mind this week at a pastor's church minister's leader's prayer breakfast I had a chance to attend. And they were talking about how the churches around our city are many times so divided, and many of those walls are coming down. We love Jesus, we love each other. You're either for me or against me. And there are lots and lots of good churches in our city. We're not in competition with them. And they're increasing unity, even amongst the races, the black pastors, the white pastors, and the big churches, the little churches, and all this kind of thing. But the thing I walked away from that most was thinking about our church, our body, our family. Are we really united? Are we really in harmony? If we're waiting for the perfect moment to do that, it's never going to happen. If we're waiting for each of the successive generations, the senior generation, the boomer generation, and the Generation X generation, and whatever's coming up at Y, and all the other ones that are coming up, to all get along about styles and all this kind of thing, it's never going to happen. We will be divided perpetually. The only thing that's going to heal that is the Holy Spirit. And this morning I want to encourage you, first of all, to ask, have you received the Holy Spirit? Do you know who the Holy Spirit is? If you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, I'll just ask you to look inside and say, Lord, take full control of my life. Be my spiritual GPS. Okay, verse 3, Titus chapter 3, verse 3. For we too were once foolish and disobedient, deceived, captives of various passions and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful, detesting one another. Those are all attributes of the lost person. Some of that looks like a church business meeting for some churches. Thank God not here at Kingsland. But that's what we once were. But when the goodness and love for man appeared from God our Savior, He saved us, not by works of righteousness that we have done, but according to His mercy, through the washing of regeneration and renewal by the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I think of the confusion that different churches have with baptism is they get confused of what kind of baptism we're talking about. When you're born again, you're baptized by the Holy Spirit. He comes in and saves you, changes you, makes you alive. You were dead, now you're alive. You were lost in sin, now you're saved. Physical baptism, which we'll do next Sunday, is a public identification with Christ. It's a first step of obedience. But we're talking about being regenerated and renewed by the Holy Spirit. Verse 6, the Spirit He poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by His grace, we may become heirs with the hope of eternal life. So how do you get eternal life? Invite the Holy Spirit to come in and take over your life. God's Holy Spirit washes you clean and totally changes you forever and ever and ever. You can't become a Christian without the Holy Spirit. What do we need? What do we need? We need the Holy Spirit. What do we need more of in our church? What's going to fix the problems at Kingsland? And you can go down any problem you have, giving problems, unity problems, size problems, growth problems, all the way down. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. We need more of Him. And what that really means is we need to give Him more of ourselves, because if you're saved, you have all of Him you're going to get. You can't get saved without the Holy Spirit. If you don't have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, you're not saved. And again, I ask you, can you remember an experience that you've had with the Holy Spirit? I can. I can remember lots. I can remember when Christ came into my life. Even though I was younger, I remember that night clearly. He came in and He changed me. Didn't mean I never messed up again. I did. But boy, when I messed up, my heart beat so hard and the conviction of God was so much on my little heart. I knew He was in there saying, don't do that. Don't do that. Stop. The Holy Spirit convicted me. I can remember my first job working for a church, and I told you about it last week, Antioch Baptist Church in Blairsville, Georgia. I'd never seen a church like that. It's a little church. But man, these people were worshiping God, and I looked over and I saw an elderly lady with both her hands in the air singing a song, worshiping Jesus. I'd never even seen that with my eyes before, maybe on television or something. I might have thought that was a little bit fruity or something before that moment. But these people loved Jesus. And the seniors, man, they led by example. And they worshiped Jesus. They knew Jesus. There was a tradition in that church of the Holy Spirit having His way. Now, no church is perfect. No church, you know, every church has difficulties. But I think about the legacy of our seniors in our church saying, lead me, Lord, I will follow. I surrender all. How many times have you sung that? That's the legacy at Kingsland. That's what we need to be doing. That's how we need to approach the future. And I have so many other instances where I've experienced those powerful experiences with the Holy Spirit. It might be at summer camp. I've had many of those. At other churches, at revival services. Don't be afraid of emotion. Don't be afraid to feel. Don't be the Grinch. Remember the Grinch? He's like, my heart, I'm feeling something. And then a tear came out. This is really weird. You remember the Grinch? You know what I'm talking about? Let's not be Grinch Christians. It's okay to feel. It's okay to have emotion at church. We don't want it to be all emotion, though. We don't want to be flopping around and every way, which way the wind blows. But I fear that sometimes we're afraid of it. Okay, you can't become a Christian without the Holy Spirit. Lastly for today, you can't live the Christian life without the Holy Spirit. You cannot live the Christian life without the Holy Spirit. Look down at verse 5. On hearing this, they had a committee meeting and voted Paul out. No, on hearing this, they were submissive. They surrendered themselves. They were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they began to speak with other tongues and languages, known languages, it's my understanding. And there were about a dozen of them in all. Listen, there is nothing boring about living a Holy Spirit-filled life. There's absolutely nothing lame or old-fashioned or whatever, you know, young people understand that when the Holy Spirit comes into your life, he's going to change you, he's going to fill you, he's going to control you, he's going to make your life worth living. And you can't live the Christian life without him. Much like a battery that's drained of its energy is useless. It has to be recharged. In Ephesians chapter 5, we are reminded that when the Holy Spirit, now this is a one-time event where the Holy Spirit baptized them, indwelt them, but there's also the sense of a continuous filling of the Holy Spirit. I want to read that to you in Ephesians chapter 5. These are familiar verses to some of you. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15, it says, "Pay careful attention then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil." I think about that a lot. How much time do we spend wasting time? How much time do we spend not on sin or some filthy, evil thing, but just wasting time? And there are so many things to waste our time with, aren't there? They don't all have to be evil, sinful things, but they're a waste of time. Don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Don't get drunk with wine, which leads to reckless action. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Listen, you can't be full of God's Spirit and full of the world at the same time, or full of sin, or full of the flesh, or yourself, or the devil, for that matter. It's either one or the other. You can't be, it's just like when you eat a meal. I remember eating a great meal down the street at a restaurant, and one of our members worked there, and they introduced me to the owner. He's like, "Oh, I have something I want here." When he put this awesome dish in front of me, I had already filled up on pizza. And I couldn't eat very much. I was already full. I couldn't eat that much more of the really good stuff because I was full of junk. And there's a spiritual application there, isn't it? Don't fill your stuff up. If we were to go into your car right now, what are the dials on your radio? What are you filling yourself up with? If we went to your video shelf or just pulled up the history on your computer, what are you filling yourself up with? If we opened up your calendar and looked at or your checkbook, how are you investing your resources? Are you making the best use of your time? Are you filling yourself up with the Holy Spirit or something else? What's it going to look like after you do that? In verse 19, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making music and melody to the Lord, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 21, submitting to one another in the fear of Christ. It's a submissive, sweet, humble attitude that the Holy Spirit. So when a Christian is, boy, look at all these things I've accomplished. Look at all these degrees I've earned. Look at all this stuff I've done. Man, when someone comes across like that, kind of pious and arrogant and full of himself, if he's full of himself, you know he's not full of the Spirit. How do you come across? How do I come across? You can't have and you can't live the Christian life without the Holy Spirit. And the application I want to give you this morning right now is just embrace the Holy Spirit. Ask him to do something fresh. Ask him to do something new in your life. Understanding this, we can get all the programs in the world. We can get all the buildings in the world. We can come up with all the game plans and all these other things in the world. None of them will matter outside of the power of the Holy Spirit working and operating in our church to make that happen. And it's the same way in your life personally, the same way in your marriage, the same way in your family, same way in our country. We have done everything possible as a nation to quench the Spirit, and I guess the quenching ended a while back, the grieving of the Spirit, and even the blaspheming of the Spirit now. What about your life? I mean, really, if you're living a Holy Spirit-filled life, if you look at our culture, your life is going to look very different than our culture. You're going to be counter-culture if the Holy Spirit's operating in and through your life. The things you say, the way you think, the music you listen to, the words you use, the stuff you watch, what you're entertained by, how you bring up your kids, it's all going to be very different. And my when I read this text, I just look at some people that didn't even know the Spirit of God existed. And what a shame that is for them. But how much more of a shame is it? 2,000 years ago, here we are today at church. And my question is, have you had a Holy Spirit experience today? Are you waiting for someone else to make that happen for you? If you don't know the Holy Spirit, invite him into your life right now. If you have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, give the Holy Spirit full control of your present and your future. Would you pray about that? Would you think on that with our heads bowed and our eyes closed? Chew on that. First of all, if you know the Holy Spirit, if you have a relationship with Christ, I want you to think of your present circumstances and even your future. And it doesn't matter how young you are. If you're alive, you have a future. It may be months, weeks, years, whatever. Hopefully decades. I would ask you right now to give full control of your present circumstances to the Holy Spirit of God. Do we even think in terms of that when we make decisions in our family? When you make job change decisions? How about our church? We should be constantly begging the Holy Spirit of God to anoint us and to guide us and to lead us. Are you submissive to the Holy Spirit? One way to look at that is, are you submissive to the people who are leaders in your life? The authorities in your life, are you submissive to them, or are you bitter and prideful and hard-hearted and stubborn? And that goes for church stuff too. How well are you doing following leadership? And every leader in the church, you have leadership that you're to follow. How well are you doing with that? Do you have a compassionate, sweet, kind, forgiving, gracious spirit, a humble spirit? Give the Holy Spirit full control of your present and your future. And if you want to pray at the altar about that by yourself, you want to take some time for that, do that. Pray where you are if you'd like. But I feel extra, just think it's extremely important today to say this. If you need to invite the Holy Spirit to come into your life today, you've never been born again. And the best way to deal with that would be to say, has your life ever changed? God never saved anybody he didn't change. If the Holy Spirit came into your life, don't you think you would know it? Don't you think there'd be some change? I do. The book of James is pretty crystal clear about that. If you want to give your heart to Jesus, you can do it right now. And it's so important to me that I want to lead you through a prayer where you can pray and invite Christ right into your life, right where you are right now. We will give you an opportunity to make a public confession about that. We will give you an opportunity to come forward and request baptism, which we will do as soon as next Sunday. But right now, in the privacy of this moment, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if you want a relationship with Jesus Christ, if you want your sins forgiven because of the blood he shed for you, just invite him into your life right now. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. He knows every one of them. There's nothing hidden with God. Everything that's hidden will be revealed. No secrets with God. And boy, on Senior Saint Sunday, what a blessing would it be for a senior citizen who realizes, oh no, I've never really had an experience with the Holy Spirit. I want Jesus Christ to come into my life through the presence of the Holy Spirit and save me right now. There is no age limitation to being born again. Jesus said, you must be born again. All roads do not lead to heaven. All roads do not lead to God. We'll talk more about that next week as we look at the second half of this and we examine the crowd, a lost crowd. If you're here today and you're sick of being lost, you're sick of being part of the crowd, the Bible says wide, wide, wide is the gate that leads to destruction. Very narrow, very small is the path, the gateway that leads to eternal life. You want to go through that gate today. That's the gate of Jesus. Invite him into your life right now. I will give you words that you can pray in your heart. You don't need to pray them out loud. The words would be something like this. Oh God, I need you in my life desperately. Holy Spirit of God, I want you to come into my life. Lord Jesus, thank you for shedding your blood for me. Thank you for your blood that covers my sins. Lord, please forgive me of my sins. Please come into my heart right now and save me. Boy, that last part is essential. Think about it. I believe that you died on that cross for me. I believe that you rose from the grave. Lord Jesus, please forgive me of my sins. Please come into my heart and save me. Right now, please come in. I give my life to you. I surrender. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, my question for you this morning is, did you just invite Christ into your life? Hopefully, many of us have done that over the years. If you just gave your heart to Christ, believe me, we are rejoicing with you, and so are the angels in heaven. If you just invited Christ into your life for the first time and you were very sincere and you meant it, you turned your back on your sins and you invited Christ into your life and you were very serious about it, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, I want you to raise your hand. I want to rejoice with you. Just raise your hand where I can see it. I don't want to miss you. Anybody like that this morning? By in the balcony? Did you pray and invite Christ into your life this morning? Go ahead and raise your hand. Oh, fantastic. So happy for you. Anybody else? Don't want to drag this out. Listen, if you've given your heart to Christ, tell somebody. Tell somebody. Get plugged into our church. Let us baptize you. If you've given your heart to Christ, but you've grown cold, listen, this invitation is for you. Oh God, take full control of my present circumstances. Take full control of my future. In Jesus' name. Would you stand with me? God in heaven, I pray that you'd take full control of our church, our present, and our future. Thank you for our past. Thank you for our legacy. But Lord, I'm extremely concerned about the future of our church and the church. Oh God, I pray that you would take full control of this church now and in the future. And I pray that you'd take full control of my life today and in the future. We surrender to you. Lord, move during our time of invitation, I pray. In Christ's name, amen. Let's sing. Come as God leads you.
I'm giving you my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams, I'm laying down my rights, I'm giving up my pride for the promise of new life. And I surrender all to you, all to you. I'm singing you this song, I'm waiting at the cross, and all the world holds dear, I count it all as lost, for the sake of knowing you, the glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your pain.
Have a seat. Thank goodness I only preach half the message, man. We're going late today. Today, believe it or not, we were going to have a testimony by Matt Currier, just a wonderful man of God who's a missionary. He and his family, Erica and the kids, are moving to Massachusetts here in a few weeks to serve Child Evangelism Fellowship through that ministry, to serve the Lord through CEF. And right now, we're going to take a love offering for the Currier family. And we want to send them away knowing that we love them, that we support them completely. And so I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward. While they're coming forward, let me introduce you to Angel, who has come forward today. She's given her heart to Jesus, and she wants to be baptized. How cool is that? So pray for Angel. Pray for the kids in our youth group. We had three kids come to Christ just last week on Wednesday night at Collision. And you'll notice the youth section practically emptied. That's because they're going over to the Family Life Center to serve lunch and honor the seniors. So I hope that you will give to this love offering that will be in support of the Currier family. Make your checks out at the Kingsland Baptist Church. We will lump all that together and present that to them. Next week, if Matt's feeling better, he will come and give his testimony that he was going to give today. But I guess it all worked out in the end, didn't it? So let's pray for this offering. Lord, I pray that you would bless Matt Currier and Erica and their beautiful children as they take their gifts and their abilities and their talents and all the passion that you put into their hearts to serve you in Massachusetts. Lord, I pray that you'd bless Child Evangelism Fellowship around the world, and I specifically pray that you'd bless the one there that Matt is going to be leading. And we pray for the one here in our city with the Good News Clubs and the After School Clubs and the Backyard Bible Clubs and all the efforts they're making to lead people to Jesus. I pray that you'd bless that organization, and we lift them up to you, that you'd give them safe travel, that you'd give them all the support they need. They need more supporters to come online and help them on a monthly level. Lord, I pray that you would provide their needs so that they can put all of their attention, not to fundraising, but to serving families, starting with children, but with the intention of leading entire families to Christ and discipling them. Pray that you'd bless this offering. In Jesus' name, amen.
Check your bulletins for upcoming events. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, you have brought us out in your house to hear your word. And we thank you, Father, for it and praise you for it. Father, we have heard thy word, and your word tell us that your word will not go forth void. So, Father, what we do, your word now is up to us. And we just pray that whatever way we need you, Father, we will. It's just a blessing of our lives, or thanking you, Father, for the blessing of our lives, or what's our need of salvation, Father. Your word will not go back into your void. It's accomplished its purpose. So, Father, we thank you for it. We praise you will be with us this coming week. We praise you will be with the seniors, Father, as we go, Father, for a lunch of which the youth have provided for us. And we thank you, Father, for them who have provided for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, let's stand and let's worship the Lord one last time as we close this service in song.
My name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church, and I want to thank you for being with us for our video broadcast of our service. And thank you for watching. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that you will get in contact with us if there's anything we can do to help you. Our phone number is 275-1285, and you can check us out on the web at kingslandbaptist.com. And we want you to know that we love you. A verse in Scripture that means a lot to me comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and it says that the love of Christ compels us, it constrains us, it motivates us. And that's really what we're all about at Kingsland, and that is connecting people with Christ, because the love of Christ compels us to do so. We've received His love, and now we want to share His love all over Chesterfield County. And maybe tonight you have questions about your spiritual destiny and whether or not you're on your way to heaven ultimately with your life. And I would encourage you to think about that, to pray about that, to talk to God about it. You see, Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. He shed His blood for your sins. And the Bible says there's none righteous. No, not one. There's none who does good. There's none who seeks after God. So the truth about humanity is that we're born separated from Christ. We're born lost. And we're really born dead, spiritually speaking. And what we need to do is to be born again. That's what Jesus said. You must be born again. And he made that possible by dying on the cross for our sins, being buried, and raising from the grave 3 days later. And you know what? That can become a reality in your life. Tonight, if you want to invite Christ into your life, do that. Ask him to forgive you of your sins. Ask him to be your Lord and your Savior. And give your heart to Jesus. And what we're here to do is to help you, help introduce you to Christ, to connect you with Christ, and to help you grow. And that's why we have our television show every Friday night. And that's why we have services here at Kingsland every Sunday. We have Bible study at 9:30 every Sunday morning. And we have a worship service at 11 o'clock every Sunday morning. And we would love for you to come and sing and learn and grow in your faith. If there's anything we can ever do for you, contact us here at Kingsland, 275-1285. And we hope to see you soon. God bless you.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home. Yeah, this is not where I belong. Take this world and give me Jesus. This is not where I of a raging sea. I have this blessed assurance.